What's it like being in the fall today compared to, for example, 15 years ago? Is it the same or?
Better.
What?
Better. You mean like 1986, you mean?
Like what? Sorry.
1986.
Not a particular year,
you haven't got your fucking shit together with Star Wars. I mean, you just go off the fucking train, don't you?
You didn't like the first question?
I'm asking.
You have to be professional, eh, lad?
I'm not.
Come on, lad.
Okay, I'll say it again.
Get fucking working, right?
Yeah. What's it like being in the fall today compared to in the early days or something?
Much better.
It's better?
Yes.
In what kind of way?
Well, when I go on stage, it's a lot clearer to me, touch wood. But there's been periods with the group where I've felt very uncomfortable on stage, you know, and recording. It's like a cyclic goes round.
Mark Smith is completely uncompromising. He really doesn't give a damn if anyone likes him at all. He's not the nicest person in the world, but he certainly is a genius, and he keeps reinventing the form as he goes, where every Fall album is compelling in its own way. There's no bad Fall records as far as I'm concerned. And to be able to have about 80 releases and have been operating shop since the mid-70s and still be going strong with no signs of letting up, there's something to be said for that. And most of the people that Mark Smith started, you know, playing with and around, you know, that early English scene, hardly any of them exist anymore, you know, at least playing music visibly where anyone's interested. Yet the Fall, all over the world, keep it, you know, they might have more fans than ever now. I mean, they are actually crossing over to a younger audience because people are seeing how incredibly hip they are.
Very little about him. He lives in a strange house in Prestwich. I don't go in. There's a strange animal that lives inside it, and it's full of stuffed creatures. Very sinister. I believe that he's possibly a warlock, and he has a power, a fetish. In primitive societies, he would have been known as the witch doctor, and he is, and in his performance, like a witch doctor.
We turned up in LA once and there was a limousine, and then we just took a right and got in a taxi instead, and that's when the penny dropped with me and I knew what I was dealing with.
In our opinion, almost
all. I suppose ask the question then, what do you exactly do?
Yeah, but the problem is that I'm saying too much, so you're just saying, you're not saying no and yes, but
yes.
On the tape, on the film, it's not going to be me on the tape, you
know.
You
want it like
yeah, too much.
Your mates have got anything to do with it.
But I was just I'm making a short intro now to I hope
right,
you
right,
say
yeah, okay. Right. We'll get, fucking get on with it.
Yeah, yeah. In our opinion. Yeah. Almost
you don't win then, why don't you feel good?
No.
Don't want Lars on.
I'm too ugly.
It'll start.
Right, go on.
Do you want to ask me how I got into the fall?
How did you get into the fall?
Oh, well, it's a long, long time ago. Probably earlier than most people, actually. I think most of us are probably dead by now.
1970s?
78.
78. Aye. That, well, that's my cousin.
It was May the 18th, as I recall. I was into punk, your bog standard punk, except for me it was Adverts and Buzzcocks, and it was the Buzzcocks were at Newcastle City Hall, and I went along there for the night, and during the warm up for the gig, they're playing various records, tapes over the PA, and this thing came over. With this hideous cacophony and this shout of right noise, and it was repetition, and it absolutely swept me away. Hypnotic.
Away, digger. Away, digger. Repetition.
See, it's amazing. Brilliant. I mean, I just remember there was just me and this piece of music, and I don't even remember the Buzzcocks, but it was just that, and this was actually, it was 3 months before it got recorded, and of course, I went away without having a clue what the hell this thing was, and I eventually...
Mental hospitals.
They put electrodes in your brain.
Mark had this office. And this kind of organisation, as I say, Mars Copeland, who's, you know, a big cheese in the music business now, had this office. And they had this single, Bingo Masters Breakout. You know, hadn't put it out. It'd been lying around for about 6 months because they were, you know, people... There were very few punk record labels that made any sense. So if a record label actually had any coherence, it would be swarmed by bands. Bands would be trying to get there. And I don't know how that record got to Mark Perry and the Miles Copeland people, but they had it, and they said, listen to this. Me and the drummer from Here and Now sat down and we listened to Bingo Masters Breakout, and then we turned it over and we listened to Repetition. We were like, this is even better than alternative TV. This is incredible. This is the best, you know, this is literally the most exciting thing we've ever heard, you know, and it isn't even out yet. Can you give us Mark's phone number? We must do gigs with him, you know. And in the beautiful innocence of punk, they said, yeah, sure, here's Mark's phone number. I phoned him up and said, you know, I spoke to Kay and said, look, you know, who'd then taken on managing the band, and said, I've got a PA. We do tours up and down England. Would you like to come? We've done some with Alternative TV. It went round really well. Would you like to come and do them? So we sort of kind of met that naissance. And so, you know, this is an incredible band, and I was the sound engineer, so I got to do the sound, you know.
When I first heard, I don't think I was too impressed when I first heard the band, to be honest. I just thought, oh yeah, it's just another scratchy kind of Manchester band. But then I saw them at a gig somewhere, and I can't remember where it was, somewhere in Manchester, where they were supporting, or were supported by Echo and the Bunnymen. I went in and the band were on, and you kind of know when something is fantastic. It doesn't even have to be fantastic on that occasion, but you know that there's something in there that is elemental and furious and magnificent, like Elvis, you know. And obviously for my kids, they can't understand Elvis at all, but when you listening to Elvis in the context of what had happened beforehand, it was just astonishing. It was frightening and almost embarrassing. It was as though a stark naked man had run in here, and you know.
Actually, my favourite falls are the first lot and the Bricks period.
The very early fall. You like that? Circus music.
Circus
music. Always gets called.
I'll never have enough circus. Oh, I've never understood that. Blue Orchids were called circus music as well.
I know what you mean, but it's a very punky kind of circus music.
It's funny. I mean, it wasn't in the background of punk. I mean, that's the thing. I suppose the EP was to an extent. Live at the Witch Trials was just so completely unlike anything else that's been done at the time.
In those days, it was kind of Carl Burns was the heartbeat of it, and obviously Mark's words, astonishing words. And then everything else kind of hung around that, you know, was kind of, so that was the spine of the band, was the drums and the vocals. And I guess, you know, I was that weird thing. I was a young punk who understood sound and got on with The Fall and thought The Fall were brilliant, because we would do gigs with The Fall. And the owner of the club would say, they've got to stop playing now, you know. You have to tell them to stop. You know, really, like, I remember doing a gig in the Bolton Tower Club, and, you know, with the pro, was just literally saying, they've got to stop now. They can't carry on they can't carry on doing this. Tell them to stop. And I'd be like, you know, and there'd be me and, you know, 20 people going, this is the best thing in the world. You know, how can you not see how brilliant that is, you know?
You know, they're playing, like somebody said on False Art the other day, something about Ludgang. It's all out of tune, the bass playing or something. It's off key or something. It doesn't sound off key to me. It sounds right. It's the right notes to play. So what's off key? It creates the right momentum in that song. So there's nothing off key about it. You know, that's just like music students, theorists and crap like that. What's that got to do with The Fall?
The thing I really like about The Fall, and the thing that really got me on The Fall, was the kind of mad pop weirdness things, where it was kind of like all this strangeness, but it was kind of like, and everyone was going bing, bong, bing, but it was actually like a pop tune.
Oh, it's not that. It's just people just develop.
They're trying to describe it. Well, they are trying to describe it. I know, I can forgive comments like that. But what I'm trying to say is, there's nothing weird about The Fall. In a lot of ways, the pop music's weird.
Yeah. Oh, it's horrible. I know, it's just complete cacophony. I don't know how people can listen to that sort of stuff.
You see these bands and they're like tarts, aren't they? Just tarts, like, you know, buy my record and I'll shag you or something. You know. What's that all that about? It's rubbish.
I was always a Fall fan. When I first heard the first Fall singles that came out, they were really important, because at the time you were like, you know, you had the Pistols and you had Clash and Gen X, you had all this kind of like, this real sort of punk rock sound. And the Fall were sort of the first band, I mean, there were other bands like it that really came out that had this other sound that was even more subterranean in a way, and it seemed it was even more sort of on this real punk level of just sort of like, being very intelligent and have a certain intellect, and then it was also wanting to sort of deal with things in a very sort of immediate and raw way, and it was done very purposefully, which I really liked.
The most special thing is just Marky Smith's brain, because he's the Fall, you know, so I think he could sing if, you know, whatever his voice was like, it would still be the Fall, even if he sounded like like a helium voice, you know? He'd make that sound good.
Hey, Mr. Pharmacist!
For years was very keen to get me in there to play with them, and so I met them and with Mark, and we, you know, had a perfectly nice time just chatting, and Craig was around, and I just never really pursued it for a couple of reasons. One was because there's a big geographical distance between New York and Manchester. Also, there was a certain spirit and camaraderie that involved a lot of like consumption of alcohol. And I'm more or less a teetotaler, I hate to say it. I don't have any moral objection to this, but it's not my scene. So I don't think it would have worked. But saying that, I would still be happy to play with them, you know, even if it was a live, you know, one-off or a session or something, because I think there's a great spirit.
I used to, you know, do speed with them.
With Mark?
Yeah, and that wife of his, that girl, I don't know, she's
yeah,
from
Briggs,
California. They were worried about me. They told us not to do so much of it.
The story he hates me telling about him is the one where a girl I knew used to go out with him, and he was an insomniac. He used to be up all night. And she said that when he got up in the morning, he used to have cornflakes with Guinness and sprinkle speed on. And that was his breakfast, you see. I mean, he hates me telling that story, but I know that it's absolutely 100% true. So fuck you.
Mark, even then, was improvising the vocals every night around what was happening. And so I would see every night, or hear every night, what he was doing to the words and how he was changing stuff.
Okay, here's the development of rap, Slate Strike Me Bass, therefore A Bays, hey Slate, give us a break.
And how, you know, something that had happened in the sound check was incorporated into the lyrics, or something that had happened on the news that day was incorporated into the lyrics, or something that happened 4 gigs ago, or whatever it was. So, you know, just right in close in this magic thing where you're, you know, there's a magic moment, and you may have had this with the four, where, you know, you're in on a secret and no one else is in on it. And I was lucky, you know, to see it over and over again.
Doctor, that amazing is crazy in future. And never, never, never gonna see it again. Get the class to the barrels. I'm driving outside, out of the city, sir. Outside, go to hell. I'm never, never, never gonna see it again. Get the juice to the grills, sir. Come on, he'll tell you. Come on, jump back. Stop in the river there. Bob Barber. We are the old talk. Transfusion. Transfusion. I'm just a big mess of confusion. I'm never, never gonna see it again. Are you going to hold
him here?
Could you describe how you still succeed in creating the special fall sound despite the numerous changes in the lineup?
You're right there, eh?
Mm-hmm.
You get enough?
Some wine for you. I spotted that.
Open it. Ed. Ed,
don't talk to me like you're a kid.
Did you want to stay in here?
Yeah, Spen was about to walk in.
Yeah.
You have to fucking edit it.
Get out the fucking door.
Let's say it's a fucking.
Yeah. Come in and talk about it. Yeah, lads. Okay, continue. Yes?
Should I say it again?
What?
Could you describe how you still succeed in creating the special four sound despite the numerous changes in the lineup?
I don't think about it, but it's not important to me.
Can I answer that? Because he's the four.
Yeah. Obvious.
Absolutely.
But so you're not conscious about it? It's just...
I don't think it's good to be conscious about it, because I think that's when you lose it.
Yeah. So when you start the... working on a new record?
Yeah, I don't listen to the old stuff.
So you start out fresh every
yeah,
time?
Yeah, got to be done.
And you've been doing this records with a lot of synthesizers, and then you go back to the basics, like... The
yeah, but I think it needed to be done, yeah.
Because?
Because... what I was doing wasn't really going anywhere, so... You never know, I don't plan ahead, you know.
So you don't know what the next one will be like?
I do.
Could you tell something about it?
I'm not going to tell you.
No.
I think he knows where he wants it to go. He always gets it where
sometimes
yeah.
Something will be too good and so he'll kind of... Do you know what I mean? Something can be too perfect sometimes and he'll find a way of making it not, you know, by I don't know, secrets.
Yeah, he create odd situations.
Secret cassettes.
Create odd situations in the studio because he does things and it doesn't work from like where we work from, which is like musicians, like this is how you do things. He always goes right against that.
In the studio, do you give him critique? Do you do?
To a certain extent. You can to a certain degree. You can do things like that, but you know, he's the boss. It's going to come out the way he wants to sound.
So sometimes you're there and you're thinking, this isn't going to work. This is going to be stupid. But you either have to walk out or you have to have trust in what he's doing.
Some bands want you to do everything for them and tell them what to do, rearrange the song and stuff like that. And Mark will have the final say, and it may be that I'm allowed to go away and do my fiddling.
It does seem like he's doing things just to be bloody-minded and to do something. It usually always works. It improves what you're working on.
Mark improvises all the time, so he'll improvise in the studio. So, you know, what I'm doing really is to try and get as much stuff out of him when he's really rocking. Just get vocal after vocal after vocal and then go and find, you know, because he might sing a verse on one take that he never sings on another take that is one of the great verses of the song, you know. And so my job is to curate. I mean, Imperial Wax Solvent is a great case in point, because, you know, I did it and I was really happy with that record. And then I probably went to Australia or something. I think I went away to Australia, and I remember having this conversation with Mark, and I was saying like, just don't screw with it, Mark. You know, it's great. It's a great record. Don't screw with it, please. You know, I'm going to go. And he said, I'm definitely not going to do it. It's brilliant, you know. And then I came back, whenever it was, month later, or 2 months later, and then I heard what he'd done to Imperial, which is what he wanted to do, and that's fine. He said, you know, but to me, it was like, what? You've done what? You've made them all mono, and you've taken out all the great vocals. I mean, one of the amazing things about Imperial Wax Solvent is that there's a song that we recorded for that album, which is one of the great Fall songs. He didn't even put it out. You know, Trowrig is another thing. Trowrig is an instrumental, isn't it, on Imperial Wax Solvent? Although people refer to a lyrical version, so maybe someone's leaked. There's a whole set of lyrics to Trowrig, which is brilliant about, and it's about walking towards the studio, and he sees Imperial, because there was the Imperial Wharf, which is that a wharf is like a thing for loading goods on off the a river. The studio was next to the River Thames, and to walk from the hotel to the studio, he had to go past the Imperial Wharf, which is, I think, where Imperial Wax Solvent comes from. And he has this he wrote this great song about Trowrig, and then I came back and it was an instrumental. And again, that's something, I'm like, okay, so you had these amazing words that were just stunning, that I loved, you know. It's a great little story about he buys a watch in a shop and it has some sort of effect on him and all these kind of things. And then you took all the words off. You know, but that's what you wanted to do, that's fine, you know, and people love that record.
He did a really good thing with this African Manor track on the new LP, where we did two versions in the studio. Then he came in and he said, oh, I'll do it again. Right, so we had to go to the pub first, come back from the pub, right, we're gonna do it again, right? So we did it, so we had three versions of it, right? He got the last version that he preferred, which was the one after a few beers. Then he cut it with a tape from a live concert of the version of the song and mixed the two. He's very good at editing.
It's two ways. We do a tune, knock it around, and if Matt likes it, he'll sing on it, or he'll dissect it, and he'll make it work. If it's not working, he makes it work.
I sort of arrange a lot.
What is the method when you make a song? Is there a special method for you use?
No.
Could you tell us about another
example? Well, I write the words, or I write the music, then it's...
He just... Oh, your old great classical guys and all that, conductors, well, that's what Mark is. But in modern terms, for me, it's a conductor, and he makes it work. And he's very clever. People, ex-band members say, oh, they wrote fuck all, Mark wrote it. And he just gave him a credit, because that's what kind of person he is. He never had to. But he oversees it all. Even from a distance, he knows what's going on. Even when he's not in the room, he knows what's going on. And then he's a conductor, he conducts it. He'll give everyone a fair chance to write some material, and if it's shit, it's in the bin. If he can make something out of it, he will do, just for the sake of the one person who might not be the best writer in the group. He gives everybody a fair chance. He installs confidence where there was none.
You like at least 50% of what you bring to him.
He has a certain guideline that you have to stick to, and you can play around within a certain area, but if you go too far, you get pulled up, you know, because he hates things being overcomplicated.
Yeah.
So if you start getting too flash, then you get brought back into line, you know what I mean? So he hates flashy bits, doesn't he?
I do.
You know what I mean? It's kind of, it's just got to be this kind of straight and powerful, and you know, that kind of thing.
No, I don't work with the musicians much. I do tell musicians what to do. I'm not a bully, but I do try and educate them in certain ways.
Could you use a song as an example?
For instance, you know, Bourgeois Blues off the new LP. Are You the Miss Minna? It's just like two chords repeated, so special arrangements I use. And
there's a lot of repetition in the songs. Is it conscious to making this trance kind of?
It's not repetition. It's like discipline. Because a lot of rock bands aren't disciplined. There's too many guitarists in the world.
People don't understand how important the band is to the Fall. And again, going back to someone like Captain Beefheart, where, you know, he had a series of different musicians in his band, but you kind of always knew it was the Captain Beefheart band, and they worked round his vision of what the music should be like. You know, these people, they come in, they become very, very important for like whatever it is, 5 years, and they become right integral to it all. And he has that way of making family. And he was saying to me, about the latest band, he was sort of saying, yeah, these are my boys, they're my boys, you know, these are my lads, they're my family.
People think that he knows what he's doing, and people think he's going on.
He doesn't know what he's doing.
He doesn't
know.
He blew his Jim's bass amp up, he just goes around and works it up full blast. He doesn't kind of alter everything a little bit to create a certain sound. He'll just kind of put his hand over and just pull everything off. But sometimes he'll go over and he'll turn my knob the wrong way and it'll turn me off. And then he'll try and put it back on and he'll give up in 3 seconds and walk away. So that's when I've got to turn around and do it again.
Sound check just in a normal way and everything, and you're just about to sort of go and have a sandwich or a beer or whatever after you thinking everything's done, and he'll come and just say, right, I want the all the drum kit moving
2 foot to the left,
yeah,
you know, what's all these fucking leads and wires doing all over here? Get a fucking move now.
It's what it's all
right. I want that amp moving over to there. What the fuck's that doing there? Come on. Like that, innit?
Yeah, he's really naughty. There's the only way to describe it, isn't
it? But it's
really
funny how it makes people jump, man.
He's really famous for saying it as well. He can't stand musicians. He hates them. He hates working with them, which is why.
I got 36 different lineups.
Yeah, but at the end of it, though, Matt's got to stand in the middle of the stage. Everyone else stands at different parts of it. He hears a different thing than everyone else does because he's right at the front. And it's sometimes it's hard to work out what he does. Sometimes he likes chaos. And he does things for the sheer sake of it being chaotic. And sometimes he does things that look like chaos, but they are quite controlled and calculated the way he does something. People interpret it in their own way, and Matt doesn't care. He likes that, he likes people to.
The new Fall members are quite young.
Mm-hmm.
Is their youth a quality that you kind of want in the band?
I think musicians, once they go over about 30, they get a bit jaded, I think. So, they get kids and that, so you have to get rid of them.
Yeah. How do you pick them?
No, there's a sort of myth about, you know, that I get rid of sack musicians all the time. It's not very true. They sort of dismiss themselves.
I can really remember very clearly that moment, though, when Craig and Steve were the road crew and then suddenly they were in the band. That was really interesting. That was really funny. So that was the first time I saw that thing happening, you know, the very first. Because obviously, as I say, I started off with Martin Brahma, Mark Riley, Una Baines, Carl Burns set up, and then to suddenly think, oh, hang on a minute, weren't those guys, that guy's playing the bass now? I'm sure he was carrying the drum kit the last time I saw them, you know.
I try and get people who are not Fall fans in the group.
And why? Why's that?
Because they come in with certain attitudes. They think they've got to be miserable or...
And they might have.
I'm going to be miserable in Manchester. And
they might have too many ideas. And they might have too many ideas about.
Oh, very, the Fall. Oh, very much, yeah. Very
yeah.
Much,
yeah. So you get them.
Seriously.
Yeah. Like
Virgil. Big problem for me.
I remember a gig in Cambridge that they did where the malevolence in the air was, I mean, I was like against the back wall with my wife and one of our children thinking, thank God they can't get at us, because he was in such a temper. And everybody in the audience was thinking, please stay up on the stage, because your friend is going to jump off the stage. And I did see a gig once where he did do that. And again, I can't remember exactly where it was, but it was somewhere in London, and some fella wasn't paying enough attention, so he just jumped off the stage and whacked him one, and then climbed back on the stage and carried on. So I quite like that, you know, the unpredictability of it. Because, you know, if you go to some big show now featuring, I don't know, Coldplay or something, even if one of them died in the course of the set, it would still carry on seamlessly to a triumphant conclusion. And so I like a band where there's an element of chance.
I did the first ever gig this band. I mean, it's a classic Mark thing. I did the first ever gig with this band that he's had now, which are, whatever it is, 6 or 7 years. God, they must be quaking in their boots that they're going to be fired. But although they're actually having a great time. But I did the first ever gig they did. And you know where that was? That was at Reading Festival. It was incredible. So Mark had been banned from Reading Festival for 10 years, right? Because he punched a roadie or something like that. Was when that's when they turned up and ended up using, they had a fight with their drummer on the way down to the gig, and they ended up using the Chemical Brothers manager as their drummer on the main stage at Reading. That's fucking, you know, 10,000 people watching you. So that must have been interesting, and I'm really pleased I wasn't there, although I'm sure it's a very interesting noise. But yeah, now I turned up at Reading, whenever it was, 5 or 6 years ago, and I was like, well, this is interesting, I've never met these people before, you know, and they were kind of like, they were there with their girlfriends, and they were kind of like, yeah, we're doing the gig, you know, and I sort of going, well, how many gigs have you done? Oh, this is the first gig, and I think this is so classic Mark. He's making his return to prove to Reading, you know, to prove to the Reading authorities that he can cut it. And he's playing to whatever it is, you know, he was on the second stage, so maybe he's playing to 5,000 people. It's a massive audience. The Fall don't often play to 5,000 people. And he's put along a band that have never played live with him before, you know. And they were great, it was a great gig and it was triumphant, but I was like, Mark, you know, this, what are you thinking? What are you thinking about this?
What is it? 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 Noch Hessen bedeutet. Realisieren die Dienste, die Dienste. Denn es soll ja ein Hutschen werden. Und er war, I wouldn't know the sun had risen unless it had press released to take to it. Und er war ein
because you go to a gig and you're like, okay, who's singing? It's Marky Smith is singing, and all I can hear is a bass guitar.
You know, I really like the bass guitar, but he's singing. He's singing these words, he's improvising these words, and I can't hear what he's saying. What is the point of going to a market, you know, to a full gig and not hearing what he's saying? You know, so I have to turn off that part of me and just try to enjoy the gig and love the gig. But I don't have that problem if I'm doing the sound, because I'm like, oh, I wonder what he's saying now. I really want to know this bit, because he's talking about, you know, an event that happened, you know, during the sound check when that guy said something to him, and I really want to see what he's talking about. Or he's talking about that guy in the jacket four rows in front of him now, you know.
We're at the Winchester Rifles, accompanied by the Blaney.
Is it a blues thing? You know, it's a folk thing almost, isn't it? I mean, it's intriguing. That is something that goes back hundreds of years, because when people were, you know, without PAs, where people were just playing to 30 or 40 people, and they would be singing, you know, the only people they would know would be that 30 or 40 people in the room. So of course they were incorporated into the song. So I love that. It's that, you know, it's like that thing where sometimes people see Mark as being right out there on the edge, you know, like of avant-garde madness, but to me there's a lot more kind of like, you know, you tear away that stuff and actually there's a lot more folk and kind of like real lyrical bluesy kind of lyrical improvisation around the events of the day.
From the home of Cheshire Cheese, Blankensy, and it's mundaneness, and happy to see you and your old pale faces, reminiscent.
Because there's certain key things about, certainly back in the day, I was so close that the references in the songs to, you know, people, names and places, I was there at those places. I was with those people. So there was, you know, when people were saying, what's this about? You know, and I would think, well, I know what it's about because I was there when it happened. You know, a lot of Mark's songs are about moments in time that have actually happened. They're not dredged from his imagination. They're actually almost documentary, you know, and he sings, you know, we were talking about this one day and he was saying, well, you know, I sing like the way people think. You know, the way you think where you have like, you have 1,000 thoughts in your head, you know, every second you're sort of thinking, I'm looking out the window, but when I was 5, I did that and I must remember to go shopping. And, oh, you know, oh, I've got the wrong socks on or whatever it is. So you've got all these thoughts going on. And I think that is something that's going on in Mark's lyrics, is that there's a huge kind of fragmented, but it's all in a coherent head.
The blessings it describes
would be annoyed with people who ask him what songs are about, because he maintains that it's bloody obvious, you know. And I would say probably 90% of the time that's true, you know, that they're very clear. But it may be that you'll only ever really get it if, you know, you come from Salford and you live in that life. I mean, if you walk round and, you know, if you walk around Mark, where Mark lives, there's his songs are everywhere. You're walking through his songs. So you're meeting people that are in his songs. You're walking through a landscape that's in his songs. He's very, I always think this, it's like Salvador Dali, you know, is sort of is this really weird painter, this really strange painter. But actually, if you go to where he was born in Spain, it's like landscape painting. Those ants that you see everywhere, the melting things, it's all the rocks, the weird formations. It's all actually just around where he was born. And that's the same thing with Mark. All these strange hallucinations and things like that actually are events and people in that area, you know. And so I think that's the intriguing thing about Mark. There's probably more documentation and less invention in what Mark does than I think most people see.
I asked him once, it wasn't too long ago, because like, before a gig it gets really edgy, and you think after like 29 years or how long he's been doing it, you think you get used to it. And I said to him, it's like, you know, do you still get nervous before a gig? And he said, Benny says, the moment I wake up in the morning, he says, I'm petrified. Don't go telling anyone that, because you probably don't want anyone to know it, but
it's still... You know, it's not a chore for him, it's not something that he turns up and does because... He does it because he likes it, he enjoys doing it, because it means a lot to him, it's his art.
It's not...
That's why he gets nervous, so about, because it's every night he is doing it, so he is making performances. How he looks, whether he looks drunk, whether he's shambling, and whatever people interpret from it, it is a performance, and he does work it, and every single performance is important to him. So he never would... If he ever gets to a point where he's not nervous before a gig, I think he'll stop doing it.
If you're not nervous, it's something wrong. Then that's when you've got a problem. If you're not nervous and you think you're jack shit and you can go on feeling not nervous, then you're gonna give a shit performance, for my money.
Because The Wedding Present, we're gonna cover a false song once, but it's so distinctive. It's all in the vocal delivery, and it's not even sung, you know, it's spoken most of the time. And you can't just do it. It just sounds. It doesn't sound right if you do it in your voice, you know. So we never managed to do it.
Chaos that appears to be the fall, you get this wonderful work. And there's, in a way, there's no such thing as a bad fall record, because there's something to be, even, I'm sure the same as, my favourite artist is Paul Clay, or if you're Powell Clay, if you're feeling particularly European about it. And you just, all of the stuff is very small scale, and you have to make it, you have to interpret it in your own way. And this is one of the things that seems to piss him off, is like people reading stuff into what he does. But you can't be him, so there, unless you are him, then all you have is your own interpretation of what the music and the songs are about. And it's the same with Clay. I can't be German-speaking Austrian or whatever he was in the Weimar Republic and growing, you know, I mean, I can't be. And so my understanding of what he does can't be his understanding of it. But I quite like the fact that I can interpret what I see in my own way. And it may be ridiculously wide of the mark, and he might, but it's the same with The Fall. You know, you're presented with this work, and you have to think for yourself about it. It's not immediate, and it's not obvious. But then it seems to me to be entirely unpretentious. And there's a lot of people who would make that same claim of their music, you know, that it was something that you had to work out for yourself. But it's usually bollocks, you know what I mean? Because the stuff they do is usually bollocks as well, when they try and present it to you as art.
I'm from Manchester as well, so it had that kind of Manchester Mancunian accent in it, going on and stuff. And then I've been a fan ever since, really. I've seen the band loads. I've actually seen The Fall more than any other band, I think.
Well, in fact, I know I have. I don't know why I say it. I think I definitely have seen The Fall more than anybody else. And I really like the two drummer phase they went through. That was really exciting. That's a great sound. I mean, actually, The Wedding Present had two drummers for a while, mainly because The Fall did it, and we thought it was a great idea, so we should have a go at that. But I think my favourite Fall album is Hex Induction Hour. I really like that. Sorry, that era. And yeah, there's really long kind of songs, which is kind of just kind of repetition, and you know, just really powerful sounding tracks. And I've met Marky Smith a few times, and it's kind of mixed, really. Sometimes he's kind of almost ignored me. All right. And then once I was in a pub with him, and he was talking to me all night, and it was really nice, and he was actually straightening my hair down for me because it was sticking out. And he kind of accused me of being like a journalist because I kept asking all these questions. I'm just a massive fan, you know. You meet Marky Smith, you know, you want to ask him questions. So
Mark Smith really is that guy who you really hoped you could be. Like, if you're in a band, you really don't want to care what anyone thinks, but you do. And you really want to be able to crank out a record every 9 months, but you can't. And you'd love to keep surprising people and kind of baffling your critics by, you know, every three albums or so turning out your best album. Like, every few Fall albums, he just keeps dropping this album where you're like, how you keep, you know, making the album that you should have not been able to make 10 years ago, you know. He just keeps reinventing it, and he stays amazingly vital decade after decade. Every musician, artist type, myself included, would love to be able to do that.
Because, you see, he's not interested in success or anything other than, he's just interested in being the Fall, Mark, and in a way he's always been only interested in that. And so that means that if you're in on it, you're on a mission. You know, you're on a mission. You're in enemy territory, and the only way you're going to get through it is if you all stick together and watch each other's backs.
Well, he's got his own agenda. He sticks to it, and people buy into it. They love it. He's not no false idiot. He's very kind, and there's not many like that, is there? They want the money here and this and that, and he's not about that. You know, we've travelled thousands of miles, not at a loss, but not for a great profit, because Mark said that's what we're doing, then that's what we're doing.
You know, you can't help but believe that there is going to be no future for the Fall. You wonder how much longer he can go on. You know, no, you know, the number of times when I've thought that I should hate, you know, it would be shockingly wrong, in the way that people used to say, I'm sure they were right, that for like blues singers, in order to do what they did at its absolute best, they had to remain in poverty and suffering and oppression. And of course that's probably true. You know, you can't be a satisfied, well-paid, fat, happy blues singer, really. It's a contradiction in terms. So perhaps in order to make Fall records, Mark has to live the kind of chaotic life and exploitative life that he seems to lead. And yet out of this wreckage, somehow fantastic work appears, and you think, that's almost miraculous.
Of course there's tension sometimes, but that's the Fall. You know, they're not a fucking cabaret band or a covers band like, you know, all Duran Duran who made it. Who made what? They're all fucking hooked on cocaine, depressed, on tranquilizers and fucking horse painkillers, aren't they? You know, you can't have a fucking 2-minute interview with any one of them without them having a line or a makeup artist there. With the Fall, it's just raw.
So I think all of us have learned, in order to be understood and to get on, to speak to people that we don't know, that we have to kind of edit out a lot of the stuff in our heads so we make sense. And Mark's in that wonderful position that he doesn't have to do that so much. So he can let that, because Eleanor, you know, provides an organisational and direction for the Fall. That means, again, you know, which Mark has always had. When Mark has been successful, there's been somebody who deals, who understands Mark, be it Kay Carroll, be it Brick Smith, be it Eleanor, who understands Mark and is willing to interrelate with the rest of the world on his behalf. And so the compromises that we often have to make in our thought processes and our verbal patterns, I don't think Mark needs to make, you know.
In a lot of ways, they're the kind of the only band you need to know about, really, because they've never been part of fashion and never will be. But people who do things that I like, and, you know, other bands, other musicians who do things that I like, will always say, oh yeah, well, you know, it was the Fall that got me into this. So I think historically they're as, you know, as important as any band has been, and I include like the Stones and the Beatles and things, because they've made people realize that they can be in bands too, and that you can be in a band without becoming teen idols or whatever. You know, you can actually, it can be quite serious work, and you can do it.
Well, Mark's a guy from the neighborhood, and I've known the work of the Fall from year zero, and I've been a convinced fan since that time. I can't really isolate one part of what he does and say that's what I like about Mark Smith, because it's a very complex package. But having said that, you know, it's a groovy train, and everybody's welcome on board. What they did, I guess, was you might call it art rock, in the same way that you might call the Velvet Underground art rock. But the main thing was the rock part of it. You know, both those bands rocked and still continue to rock.
If he died before me, and I think he'll keep on doing it until he does die, or ends up in an institution of some sort, I hope he does. I mean, keep going, not end up in an institution. But if he stopped before I died, there would be a terrible emptiness in my life. A life without the Fall would be inconceivable, really, in the same way like a life without Liverpool Football Club or without my wife and children. It's that central to my life. And like, as with any of these things, something that you really care about should be essentially inexplicable. And a lot of these people write to me and say, you know, I heard the Fall, which record should I get? And I never have any hesitation in telling them, you must get them all, because it's impossible to pick one. You know, you have to have them all. You do. And you have to have any, you know, any new record that comes out, something, you know, live in Nova Scotia 1984 or something. You know, even if the sound quality is terrible and he was pissed, or he just fired half the band or whatever, you still have to have them. You do. So there is no answer to that question. And in fact, I'll go further. I'll say anybody who can tell you the five best Fall LPs or the five best Fall tracks has missed the point, really. It's the it's the whole body of the work that is to be applauded.
Bye.
Yeah, yeah, let's start this where it all started. 1996, Roskilde Festival. Three stupid Danish Fall fans, the Winking Vikings. And now, Christiana, July 6th to 27th, Gallipoli. Let's go, yeah, Container Drivers, a film 12 years in the making, featuring Dee Dee Ramone, David Gedge, and Stephen Malkmus. 12 years in the making, let's go, heroes painting in England, USA, France, and Netherlands, Marty Smith and Brand B. Strand, the Copenhagen setup, Let's go, yeah, a film 12 years in the making, featuring Thurston Moore, Damo Suzuki, and Grant Showbiz, 12 years in the making, let's go, Container Drivers, let's begin where all did begin, 1996, Roskilde Festival, three stupid Danish Fall fans, the Winking Vikings, and now, in Christiana, July 6th to 27th. Let's go. Container Drivers, a film 12 years in the making, featuring Peter Hook, John Peel, and Gary Lucas. 12 years in the making. Let's go. Yeah. Container Drivers. Yeah. Let's go.